Thank you very much for that introduction, and thanks to everybody for being here. Particularly thanks to Professor Chun for his kind invitation to me to be here today. I think I see some faces I know, but I hope to get to know more of you during the week. I hope you're going to find my talk very relaxing, because it's not going to be at a very high level today. It's not going to be taxing for many of you. It will be revision, and I'll take things slowly. However, I am going to begin with a mistake, which I'm going to correct immediately. So just to correct it, the permutations that avoid 1, 2, 3, as we talked about this morning, are enumerated by the Catalan numbers. I think everybody knows that. So what I should have said here was that the permutations that avoid the consecutive pattern. So if you have any notes there, the pattern 1, 2, 3 should actually be the consecutive pattern 1, 2, 3. These are counted by a sequence that begins, as you see there, 1, 1, 2, 5, 17, 70. And I'm not sure, maybe Sergei knows who did it, but it would not have been easy, I think, to find that it's to have found that the generating function of that sequence is, as you see it there, √3/2 e to the x divided by 2 over the cosine of 3x/2 plus π/6. In fact, I think the 3 in 3 here possibly should be √3/2 as well. Yes? Yeah, yeah, it's a wonderful result. Very nice. Now, these numbers work out to be moments for a family of orthogonal polynomials. I suppose this is going to be part of the theme of what I'm talking about, that many times when you enumerate something, a first question you ask, could these possibly be the moments of a family of polynomials? So these numbers are the moments associated to a family of orthogonal polynomials. So right away, we're looking at pattern avoidance and orthogonal polynomials. So it's a bridge from discrete mathematics over into continuous mathematics, if you like, whose coefficient array is given by, it so happens in this case, by an exponential Reardon array. And the exponential Reardon array is written down thus. So for those of you familiar with this, we describe Reardon arrays by giving two power series, a first one and a second one. The first one is the generation function of this pattern avoidance sequence. And then the second one is related to it in a way which we might see later on. So, and the polynomials have as a coefficient array the inverse of this array. So that already tells you that the inverse does exist. So this is giving a hint to the fact that Reardon arrays belong to a group, that they are invertible. Now, just to use some vocabulary of Reardon arrays, which I will explain later on for those of you who haven't met it, the production matrix of the exponential Reardon array that you see there. So this is the Reardon array that has the enumeration of the pattern avoiding numbers here in its first, that's the first column, that generates the first column of this infinite matrix. So the production matrix begins like this. And what we notice immediately is, apart from the very nice numbers we see there, is that this is tridiagonal in form. And it's the very fact that this is tridiagonal that allows us to say that it is associated with orthogonal polynomials. And not only is it tridiagonal, but it's got very nice numbers here. It's got ones down the super diagonal. In this instance, it happens to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 here. And then here we see the squares of those numbers. So it's a particularly nice tridiagonal production matrix. And when you get practiced, you can immediately go from something like this to this three-term recurrence. That's extraneous, my apologies. So the corresponding family of orthogonal polynomials satisfies the three-term recurrence. It's three-term because we've got n, n minus 1, and n minus 2 here. So Pn of x is equal to x minus n Pn minus 1 of x minus n minus 1 squared Pn minus 2x. And we can see where these numbers, the n comes from. That's just these numbers here. And the n minus 1, again, these numbers here. And then if we take the inverse of this array here and look at its first two rows, we can immediately say that the p0 of x is 1 and p1 of x is x minus 1. So just going back, that all began with this sequence here. It enumerates those permutations that avoid the consecutive pattern 1, 2, 3. So that's a set of numbers. So immediately you ask yourself, what can I say about this set of numbers? Well, what I can say about this set of numbers is that they are the moments associated to a family of orthogonal polynomials, and those polynomials are precisely given, prescribed by this three-term recurrence. Now, the ordinary generating function, so we've seen the exponential generating function. Well, the ordinary generating function of the moments may be expressed as a continued fraction. And then if I want to say more, I can say that the Hankel transform of the moments of these numbers is given by this quantity. So there is a theory that allows me to say write this down immediately. Now, it's interesting that the Hankel transform here is really critical in that it is the fact that these Hankel transforms, these numbers here, are non-zero that immediately allow me to say that this is a sequence of moments. So I'm doing things slightly backward. What I would do is normally I'd look at the Hankel transform of these numbers, see if they seem to be non-zero, and that makes them a good candidate for being the a moment sequence for a family of orthogonal polynomials. Now we'll see more of these type of continued fractions again. They were studied in the 18th and 19th century by the classical mathematicians. In more modern times, they were studied by a great mathematician who unfortunately died not so long ago, Philippe Flageolet. And he got interested in them because he wanted to quantify or measure aspects of algorithms to do with file handling. So he wanted to look at three operations when you handle files: insert, delete, and query. And he wanted to put a cost on compositions of such operations. And the numbers you see here, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 1, 4, 9, these were the numbers that he used to characterize these operations. So this continued fraction here can be related to algorithms, and that is what he did. Now, if you look at the Hankel transform here, it's k plus 1 squared to the power of n minus k. So the k plus 1 squared actually comes from these numbers here. That's where you find the squares. So we'll see in general later on that the Hankel transform is related to the powers, to the coefficients of the x squareds, that the coefficients of the x's don't play a role. Okay. Now, if you want to know more about any sequence of integers, but in particular this sequence, then you look it up in the online encyclopedia of integer sequences. So I'm sure a lot of you know that. So, for instance, this sequence is sequence A049774 in the OEIS, and the Hankel transforms are given by that sequence. So more details on these sequences can be found there. However, you're free, if you discover anything, to add more knowledge to the encyclopedia. It is a wonderful store of knowledge which is very much open to and accessible to anybody who has information about these sequences. Okay, now, here's another exponential Reardon array. It actually has the same function here as in the other one we were looking at, but this is different. So we've changed the first power series, but we've left the second power series the same. And what this one does is it counts k forests of planar increasing unary binary trees with n nodes. So this function here is a bridge between pattern avoidance in permutations and increasing trees. So its inverse is also the coefficient of an array of orthogonal polynomials given by this expression here. So we've swapped n minus 1 squared for n times n minus 1. So that's the difference that is brought about by changing this generation function. So Reardon arrays can tell us a lot about enumerative objects. And in some cases, nice cases, we can bridge back to sequences of polynomials, such as these orthogonal polynomials, or indeed other interesting families of polynomials. Now, when you've got a sequence, you often want to transform it. And one of the most common transforms is, as a lot of you will know, is the binomial transform. So if AN is a given sequence, its binomial transform is this sequence here. You just multiply the sequence element AK by N choose K, and then you sum up. Now, it so happens that if AX is the generation function of A sub N, then BX, the generation function of the Bs, is given by this expression here. 1 over 1 minus X, A into X over 1 minus X. That was studied by Euler, and it's often called Euler's transformation. So it goes way, way, way back. Expressed modernly in terms of Reardon arrays, we can write it down like this. It's the Reardon array, and again, if you haven't seen a Reardon array, I'll explain that later on, but it's this simple Reardon array. You can see the correspondence here, operating on the generating function AX. Similarly, if A sub E of X is the exponential generation function of AN, then the exponential generation function of the sequence BN, related to AN by this, is given by, quite simply, E to the X multiplying AX. And again, in terms of exponential Reardon arrays, it's this exponential Reardon array operating on A of X. Now, one reason why I wanted to bring that in is to just underline the fact that the Hankel transform of the sequence AN and of BN are the same. So the Hankel transform is most definitely not injective. It is surjective, but not injective. So a Hankel transform may have many pre-images.
Good question. On the second line, is it by purpose? No,
not deliberate. That's a mistake. And obviously, this is just to separate them visually. It's convention. And another convention here is that the round brackets here is for ordinary Reardon arrays using ordinary generation functions. I use a square bracket. Some people use an angle bracket to denote an exponential Reardon array. Oh yes. Sorry. So back to this example. So in talking about this, I've used terms like sequence, exponential generation function, moments, family of orthogonal polynomials, coefficient array, inverse exponential Reardon array. So what I want to do is I want to spend some time on the meaning of all of these. Obviously, everybody knows what a sequence is, but for the rest, I'll just explain them. Similarly, we came across the term production matrix. So again, I'll explain what a production matrix is. This is a typical format. By the way, all these matrices are truncated. Reardon arrays are of infinite extent to the right and downwards, and we normally show a reasonable truncation, enough to get an idea of what the Reardon array might look like. The correspondence family, etc., three-term recurrence, so I want to talk about three-term recurrences. Ordinary generating functions, continued fractions, Hankel transform, all of these I will talk about. And then the linkage between this Reardon array and increasing trees, so I'll talk a little bit about increasing trees. So they're going to be one of the main data structures that I look at. Similarly, binomial transform we've looked at. And these formulas here, B of x is equal to this Reardon array times that generation function. This generation function is that Reardon array times that generation function. These are examples of what we call the fundamental theorem of Reardon arrays. Okay, that's the introduction. A little bit about me. I did my degree in 1974. Maybe some people weren't born then. But anyway, I did. I did a diploma in Bordeaux in 76, and then I went to work. So I'm a relatively new person to mathematics in terms of active mathematics. I actually got my PhD in 2009. So some of you may feel that you should be intimidated by me. Not at all. I'm intimidated by you. We're almost on the same page. So anyway, just to mention that last year, or in fact just published this year, I've written a book on Reardon arrays. There it is. So there is a book available, though it's for the novice. It's not for practiced people like yourselves. Anyway, so preliminaries on orthogonal polynomials. One of the big names in orthogonal polynomials is Chebyshev. So that's a picture of him in older age. I feel a bit like him myself. But anyway, so these are his dates. So orthogonal polynomials can be prescribed by a three-term recurrence, so long as you specify boundary conditions. So typically boundary conditions might look like this, or else you could begin with P0 and specify P1. So notice the form. We've got Pn plus 1 of x is equal to x minus alpha n, and this is minus beta n. So there's an alpha n and a beta n. There are various names given to these coefficients. Sometimes they're called the Markov coefficients. I generally just call them alpha n and beta n. The beta n's go at the end. The alpha n's are associated with x minus alpha n. Because that begins, P0 is of degree 0, and we're bringing in an extra x every time, these polynomials, Pn is of precise degree n. So that is important. Now, the normal way of describing a family of orthogonal polynomials is to prescribe a linear functional, which I'll write down as an integral here. But more abstractly, we have a linear functional operating on the product of Pn and Pm. And so long as when n is different from m, this linear functional operating on the product is 0. And so long as it's non-zero when n and m are equal, then we have orthogonality. So that's the normal idea of orthogonality. So in this case, we're assuming that there exists an appropriate measure mu. This is where the Hankel transform comes in, and where we assume that the Hankel transform, which depends on these beta n's, is non-zero. If that is the case, then there will be a measure. Now, the moments for that family of orthogonal polynomials are these elements an, or sometimes called mu sub n, which is equal to just the integral of the monomial x to the n d mu x. Now, if we have these moments, we can recover the polynomials using a determinantal formula. So just to get P2 of x, what we form is a Hankel matrix. Now, a Hankel matrix is a matrix where the elements on the diagonal are constant. So we just take A0, A1, A2 in this instance. We shift it, So we begin now with A1, A2, A3. So we have A1 and A1 there, A2 and A2 there. Whereas of bigger size, we'd have A3, A3, A3. And in this case, to produce a polynomial, we replace the A elements by the monomials, 1x, x squared here, divide by this minor, we have a minor there, divide by that, and that will give us a polynomial, which in this case would be P2 of x. So if we have the moments, we can generate the polynomials. Now, other formulas or recurrences, the bases are specified. This matrix here, for instance, this Hankel matrix is H1. H2 would be this matrix here, except with A2, A3, A4 here. So following on, the bases have this formula, quite an important formula in mathematics. And notice it's a recurrence. It's a recurrence for, if you like, either beta n or for h n plus 1 if you know beta. The alphas are given by this formula here, where the hn's are the Hankel matrices that we've seen. The h stars are the same Hankel matrices, except the last column is the next column, if you like, of the Hankel matrix. So instead of going a0, a1, a2, we skip to A3 here. Instead of going A1, A2, A3, we skip to A4 here, and so on and so forth. That basically is an application of Cramer's rule. So we know if we have the A's, we can form the H's, and then we can get the betas and the alphas. Okay, Stielke's worked with these and a lot more. So he's an important person in this story. Now, the moment generating the generating function of the moments mu of n can be obtained by this integral here. So that's called the Stielke's or the Cauchy transform. Assuming we know the measure, we can take the Stielke's transform of the measure. That will give us a function in x, which in fact is the generating function of the moments. You can reverse this if you know small g, the generating function of the moments. Then you can form capital G. You can form this integral of the imaginary part of g of x plus iy. You can take that limit, y going to 0 from the positive side. And if all goes well, if that limit does converge, then you will get a representation of the measure. So you can start with the moments, find a generating function, or start with the measure and get the generating function. And from that, if you've got the generating function but not the measure, you can get the measure in this instance. Now, if wx dx is the absolutely continuous part of mu, notice here this means we've got an atomic measure based at a point S and at a point T, whilst this is a continuous part or a differentiable part. So the differentiable part of the measure can be obtained directly from this formula here. Okay, so that's abstract enough. So let's have a look at a particular orthogonal polynomial family. And the one I've chosen is the probably the simplest you could think of, and that is the Chebyshev polynomials of the second kind. So they're defined by that formula there. The binomial n minus k choose k, minus 1 to the k, 2x to the n minus 2k. And if you just look down here, this is what they look like. P of 0 or u of 0 is that, u of 1, u1 is that, u2 is that, u3 is that, etc. So these ones in particular are not monic. In other words, the coefficient of the highest power of x is not 1. And that's obviously due to the 2 there. Now, they satisfy a very simple recursion or recurrence, and it's this recurrence here. So notice we have the 2 here appearing here rather than in my previous slide. I just had x minus alpha n and that was to do with monic polynomials. So this is not monic. And it so happens that the measure associated with these polynomials is this measure here. And it's supported by the interval minus 1 to 1. So this is the measure with respect to which these polynomials are orthogonal. Just to show you what the moments look like, the normalized moments of this measure begin like that. So they're non-integral, they're fractions. You can write them down in a formula form like this. And if you use the determinantal formula, this is what you would begin. You'd begin with 1, 0, a quarter, is 0, an eighth. So in this instance, that matrix there, or that determinant rather, divided by this determinant, will give you 4x squared minus 1. So if we have the moments, we can recover the polynomials. Okay, so I'm going to go through some generalities in generating functions very quickly. I understand that most of you would be very familiar with this. I didn't know it, but De Moivre, whom we all know from complex analysis, he apparently was the first person to use generating functions to solve a recurrence. So that's what he looked like. So just to lay the groundwork, if an is a sequence, and generally speaking, I'll always index my sequences from 0. There are two conventions, normal conventions. One is to index from 0, one is to index from 1. I always index from 0. So an expression of the form ax equals to this sum, which of course is a formal infinite sum. We're not worried about convergence here at all. It's just a convenient way to represent things compactly. It's called the ordinary generation function of an. Similarly, a sub e of x, this expression, so now rather than having the monomial xn, I'm taking xn over n factorial. This will be an exponential generating function of the sequence. So in either case, we've got the coefficient an of x to the n, so I'll use this notation. That notation there, square bracket x to the n, means this is the operator that extracts from the generating function the coefficient of x to the n. It'll be equal to an. Similarly, for the exponential generating function, I have to multiply the result of applying this operator by n factorial. Okay, so these are the coefficient extraction operators. More generally, if Cn is a sequence such that none of the Cn's are zero, then we can define a general generating function which where I take x to the n over Cn as my general power of x. So it will be written like this. And in this case, a sub n is given by Cn multiplying the extraction operator on the generating function. So obviously, for the ordinary generating function, the Cn's are 1. For the exponential generating functions, the Cn's are n factorial. But it often happens that other choices of Cn are useful. And many of these types of alternative weights, if we want to call them that, arise in, for instance, mathematical physics, where there's good physical reasons why you would use them rather than the normal choices. Okay, just a little bit of calculus here. It's very simple. If we take the exponential generating function there of a sequence, the sequence of Cn's, and if we take its Laplace transform. So writing down this Laplace transform, for phi of t, we put in the summation. The summation is over k, which is not involved in the integration, so we can take the summation out. So we're left with this integral here. This integral works out to be just 1 over x to the k plus 1. So this expression here is 1 over x, g of 1 over x, where g is the ordinary generating function. So the Laplace transform is a bridge between the exponential generating function and the ordinary generating function. And writing it in terms of 1 over x, what we have is that the ordinary generation function is equal to this expression when this expression makes sense, where in there you have the exponential generation function. I've learned recently, I didn't know it, that this transform, this variant on the Laplace transform, is sometimes called the Tsumudu transform. So you can bridge from the ordinary generation, from the exponential generation function to the ordinary generation function. To do the reverse, you do have to use contour integrals, but it is possible, just as you can invert the Laplace transform. Okay, we all know that generation functions are useful when they can be written in a compact form and manipulated algebraically. So the easiest generation function that we all know is the generation function of the sequence of all ones. So this is literally this expression here. It's the sum for n equals 0 to infinity. Sorry, that should be infinity. My apologies. Of x to the n. And we all know that a short way to write this is 1 over 1 minus x. And it's this short form that gives it its power. You all know also that this could be seen either by carrying out, as you did in school perhaps, the division of 1 by 1 minus x and just seeing what happens, or by using an extended binomial theorem. Now, the power of generation functions is seen, for instance, when we look at convolutions of sequences. So for instance, here's an example. If this is the ordinary generation function of the sequence fn, and this is the ordinary generation function of the sequence g sub n, then the product of these two generation functions becomes the generation function of the convolution of these two sequences. Similarly, if we've got exponential generation functions, the same thing happens, except that when you multiply these out and see what happens, you actually have an extra binomial term that comes in here. So this is the, if you like, the exponential convolution of these two sequences. So quite similar, except here we have no binomial, here we have a binomial. Okay, so that brings us on to the binomial theorem. I'll just race through this very quickly. You're all familiar with it. We know, obviously, that a plus b to the n is equal to either of these expressions here. Okay, no problem. When n is a negative integer, then obviously we get a minus n here, but now the summation has to go to infinity or to whatever the appropriate value is. And how do I find that? Well, we use this formula here, that minus n sub k, that's where n is positive, is equal to this expression here. So for instance, if I wanted to use the binomial theorem to prove that 1 over 1 minus x is indeed the generation function of the all one sequence, I could do it like this. So I take the, I use the extraction operator on 1 over 1 minus x, expand that using the binomial theorem, this is what I get. Use this formula here with n equal to minus 1, so I get this, k plus 1 minus 1k. The ones cancel, I'm left with kk, that's 1. So when I pull out the coefficient of the nth of the nth power of x, it'll just be 1. Now, of relevance to Reardon arrays is to take the use the extraction operator on a kth power. That essentially will be a kth power, or at least 1 over 1 minus x times a kth power. So just to get a bit of practice at this sort of thing, there is a rule which says if x of n operates on an xk, I can absorb it into xn minus k. So then I'm using xn minus k in brackets operating on 1 over 1 minus x to the power of k plus 1. So the negative k plus 1 here appears here. I use my rule to change this to k plus 1 plus j minus 1. There will be an additional minus 1 to the j, but that cancels the minus 1 to the j that's here. So I've just got x to the j. 1's cancel, k plus j, j. substitute in the n minus k when I extract the operator on the x to the n here. So that collapses this sum down to one element. K plus n minus k, the k's cancel. So that gives me n sub n minus k, and then using the normal symmetry of Pascal's triangle, that just gives me n choose k. So what this is telling me is that this generation function here, which does of course depend on k, that this is the generating function of the kth column of Pascal's triangle. Okay, for Reardon arrays, the very important operation is to invert them. And one of the tools we use to invert them, or at least to know what the coefficients of an inversion are, is Lagrange inversion. So just very quickly to go over what that is. If f of x is a power series like this, so we've got a zero constant term, we begin, the first non-zero coefficient is that of x. Now, the solution to this equation, f of u equals x, which satisfies u at 0 is equal to 0, is called the reversion of f. So it involves solving an equation. And we shall denote this by either f bar of x or by the reversion, rev, of f at x. So we have two properties that are important. F bar applied to f will give you x back, or is the identity, if you like. And f of f bar, again, is the identity. So whichever way you use them, f bar of f or f of f bar, you'll get back what you began with. These are equivalent ways of writing these. F bar of f bar bar is of x is x. Now, what Lagrange inversion allows us to do is to extract the coefficients of f bar of x using a knowledge of those of f. And as the name suggests, Lagrange was one of the main people who worked on this. So it's a very simple formula in its simplest form, and this is what it looks like. G here is just some function that we can compose with f bar. So the nth the coefficient of x to the n in this composition of power series, where the inner one involves the reversion of f, will be equal to 1 over n times the n minus the coefficient of x to the n minus 1 of what? Well, of the derivative of g in terms of x times x over f of x to the n. So we're actually relating the coefficients of f bar, or of g of f bar, not directly to the coefficients of f of x, but more to the coefficients of x over f of x. Now, because f bar bar is f, by symmetry, we can have f here and f bar here. And we use whichever version is the one that is easiest to deal with. Sometimes f bar is easier to deal with than f, and vice versa. So it's a very handy device when you're inverting Reardon arrays. Okay, so let's have an example. We'll take f of x to be this simple function, sometimes called the logistic function, x into 1 minus x. Now, it's not hard to revert that. You basically call that u, and then it's u, 1 minus u equals x. That will give you a quadratic. You solve that quadratic using the normal formula, and this is what you get. So f bar of x is equal to this. And then we might want to get the nth the coefficient of x to the n in the kth power of this expression. Now, you could tackle that head on, but the square root is not a nice thing to deal with. And a binomial using a square root is harder still. So we go the other way. We go from f bar here on this side of the equation to f down here. And it so happens in this case that that, by the way, is the derivative of the kth power. That's my composition function. These x's cancel. So I'm left with k over n, x to the n minus k, 1 minus x to the n. And then I just use my normal binomial devices until I get down to this expression down here. So I avoided having to deal with the square root here by using Lagrange inversion. So we can use Lagrange inversion to find the simplest path to what we want. Okay, now continued fractions. Continued fractions are of many sorts. One is called the S continued fraction, Selke's continued fraction, which is where you only have powers of x. You don't have powers of x squared or x cubed or combinations of any. Here I've chosen the very simplest S fraction where the coefficients of the x's are all 1. Now, to many of you, this should be a very familiar object. We can solve, we can actually find what f of x is by noticing that if f of x is equal to u, then essentially this is telling us that u is equal to 1 over 1 minus xu. U there is repeated here. So that's just a quadratic to be solved in u squared. Solve it, and you get this formula here, which many of you will recognize as the generating function of the Catalan numbers. So that's just a simple example of an S continued fraction. Of more immediate importance to us is a J continued fraction, J for Jacobi, by the way, which is normally of this form here. So we find again our alphas and our betas. Now, these can be associated with lattice paths. Lattice paths, at their simplest, are paths that go up, that can take a flat step, and can go down. And the alphas are generally associated with the flat steps, and the betas are a combination of the up steps and the down steps. As I said, they can also be associated with algorithms to do with files, where these could be the costs of insertions, and these could be the costs of deletions. So they do have a value in algorithms as well. Now, it so happens that an S-type fraction like this can equivalently be written as a J-type fraction like this. So notice what we're doing. We're taking A1 and multiplying it by A2. We're taking A3 and multiplying it by A4. And then for the coefficients of the x's, we're taking A2. Well, we're leaving A1 alone. There it is. And then A2 plus A3, A4 plus A5, etc. So these forms are equivalent in the sense that we can go from here to here. It's not so easy to go from this type of a fraction back to this type of a fraction without the introduction of, if these are integers, without the introduction of fractions. Now, there are other types of forms of common types of continued fractions. This type of fraction is sometimes called a T fraction, where we have to the power of x here, but we also have to the power of x here. So if we look at this particular fraction, again, I'm taking the simplest forms where the coefficients are all 1. You can solve this easily by saying u is equal to 1 over 1 minus x times u. And the solution is this generation function here, which many of you will recognize as being the generation function of the large Schroeder numbers. Equivalently, in this case, we can write that fraction in this form, in a Jacobi form. So if 2's all down here, we've 3's all here, except for 2 here. And these count, they count the large Schroeder numbers, but they also count the number of colored Motzkin paths, with each up step and each flat step at ground level getting one of 2 colors. So there, I'm reading that 2 and 2 there. And each flat step not at ground level getting one of 3 colors. So these are the numbers related to flat steps, and they're all 3. So we have 2 colors at the lowest level, and then as we rise up in the path, we have 3 colors available. Okay, very quickly I'll talk about recurrences. So sequences can often be described by recurrences, where, as you all know, we prescribe how to construct the elements of the sequence in terms of known prior values. So we all know that. The simplest example being that of the Fibonacci numbers. So any Fibonacci number is the sum of the two preceding numbers. Now, what is of interest is to be able to go from that recurrence to the generating function. And we know normally the technique to employ. You multiply each side of this equation by x to the n, and you sum it from the lowest number you can, which in this case is 2, up to infinity. So that will give you an equation like this. Notice that already we can take x out as a factor there, and x squared as a factor there. So we're anticipating something in x and x squared. We then have to add in the initial conditions, which are that f of 0 is equal to 0, f of 1 is 1. Solve the equation that ensues, and you get this quite easily. So recurrences can give generating functions. The Catalan numbers, for instance, these numbers here that you all know, they satisfy a convolution type recurrence. So that recurrence involves products and sums of products. In any case, you can do a similar manipulation, and we find that the generating function for these numbers is this number here, which we've seen is is 1 over x times the reversion of x into 1 minus x. So typically, I'll use small c of x for this generation function, capital C of n for the Catalan numbers. Some people reverse that convention. Now, we don't have to confine ourselves to recurrences in one variable. We can, of course, have recurrences in many variables. But for instance, take two variables. So the Stirling numbers of the second kind, for instance, satisfy this recurrence here. Now, the Stirling numbers of the second kind count many, many things. They count the number of ways to partition a set of n objects into k non-empty subsets. I assume most of you know that. They also count forests of k increasing unary trees on n nodes. So they can be related to other data structures moving from sets to trees, for instance. Here's an interesting recurrence. So you may want to just note that down if you want to do any exercises this afternoon. A n plus 2 times a n is equal to a n plus 1 squared plus 1. Or more generally, solving for a n, if you like, a n is equal to a n minus 1 squared plus, let's say, s rather than the 1 that's here, over a n minus 2. Now that recurrence involves a division. So there's no reason to think that when you go to solve it, that you will get integers. But it so happens that if you begin with a0 equals to 1, a1 equal to some integer r, and if you let s be rk plus r minus 1, then the solutions will be integers. And not only that, they are linked to special Reardon arrays. So if anybody wants to do an exercise, they can find me what those Reardon arrays are. OK, so polynomial families. Polynomial families, for me, will just be sequences of polynomials. So we're back to sequences and all the machinery that allows us to define sequences, but wherein P of n is of exact degree n. Now, what that means is that each Pn of x can be written as a summation from k equals 0 to n of some set of numbers, a n comma k, x to the k. So each summation just goes out to n. So what that means is that this matrix here of these numbers will be lower triangular. So associated with every family of polynomials, as I define it there, there will be a lower triangular matrix. And I'll call that matrix the coefficient array of the family of the polynomials. So some examples. Well, we just take the set of binomials, 1 plus x to the power of n. Well, by the binomial theorem, we know that each pn of x is equal to this expression here. So the coefficient array in this case is Pascal's triangle. 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 1, 3, 3, 1, 1, 4, 6, 4, 1, each representing 1. 1 plus x squared, 1 plus x squared, 1 plus x cubed, etc. So that's a typical coefficient array for a polynomial family. And of course, what I mean by that is if you multiply this matrix, or if you multiply this monomial vector by that matrix, you will get these binomials. Okay, let's take this this family of products of x plus k. So these are well known, x into x plus 1, x into x plus 1 plus x plus 2. And what we find here is that the coefficient array is none other than our Sterling numbers of the second kind. And visually, this is what that matrix looks like, or this is how it begins. So again, we've got the picture of this matrix of the Sterling numbers of the second kind, multiplying the monomials, giving these products. Okay, so orthogonal polynomials for us will be such a family of polynomials, and they are linked directly to continued fractions, as we've seen before. So if we have a family of orthogonal polynomials, which are a polynomial family in the sense that I described, we can link them to this continued fraction. So here are the alphas, here are the betas. And putting it together in a continued fraction gives me a generation function. So obviously the question is, what is that the generation function of? But we know that it's the generation function of the moments of the orthogonal polynomials. Okay. So just going back to the Hankel transform now of these moments, if the moments have a generation function of this form, then the Hankel transform, which in this case is just the determinants of the matrices whose elements are given by mu I plus j. So as I plus j run from 0 to n, this will give me a matrix whose anti-diagonals are whose anti-diagonals are constant. Now, these determinants can be evaluated from a knowledge of these betas. And this is the formula. It's called the Heilermann formula. I should have written that down. It's quite an old formula. So the Hankel transform is easily evaluated once we can evaluate the betas. And you will remember that I gave a determinantal formula for the betas once you have the moments. Okay. This gentleman, many of you know. I'm going to stop very shortly, by the way. But this is Lou Shapiro, a frequent visitor here, I understand. So Lou and two of his colleagues were at the origin of what we now know to be Reardon arrays. So I'll just give the briefest of introductions to Reardon arrays, and then I'll continue tomorrow. So this is the foundational paper that Lou and Getu, Wohn, and Woodson wrote. They wrote it, well, the date there of publication is 1991, but I presume they've been writing it for some time before that. And they very boldly entitled it the Reardon group. Nobody had called anything a Reardon group before. And if you notice down here, with the recent death of John Reardon, this seems appropriate to name after him. So they discovered that a set of matrices formed a group. And out of respect for John Reardon, who was a very well-known American combinatorialist, they named it after him. So this paper, it's a very short paper. It's very clearly written. It immediately makes it obvious that these are nice objects. This is the paper that started Reardon arrays, so 1991. So a very recent origin. And what that means is there's still plenty to be done. So just very briefly, preliminaries on Reardon arrays. Now, Reardon arrays are based on the datum of two generation functions. One generation function has a constant term, G0, which is non-zero. The other generation function has a constant term, which is zero, and which then has a non-zero coefficient of x. We don't mind about G1, but F1 here has to be, G0 here has to be non-zero. This has to be zero, and F1 here has to be non-zero, at least in terms of standard Reardon arrays. So we've got two generation functions, and out of that we want to form a matrix. And the matrix element, the nkth element of the matrix, is the coefficient of x to the n in the product of power series g of x times f of x raised to the k. So it's a very, very simple definition. What it'll turn out is that g by itself generates the first column, g times f generates the second column, g times f squared generates the third column, and so on and so forth. Okay, these are ordinary generation functions. So the matrix, whose general elements are these, is called the ordinary Reardon array, and we use round brackets gx, comma f of x as the notation to denote that. Now, it's not immediately obvious, but it so happens that this is a lower triangular matrix. And not only that, but in the case where G0 there is 1, and this is 1, then we'll have 1s down the main diagonal. Similarly, if we have exponential generation functions, then taking as general element n factorial over k factorial, the coefficient again, the n coefficient of x to the n in the product g of x times f of x to the k, we form an exponential generation, an exponential Reardon array. This is Philippe Flageolet, who I've referred to before, who was one of the fathers of modern analytic combinatorics. He never used Reardon arrays, but a lot of what he has done is relevant. So I'm going to stop here, but just to let you know what I will be doing in the next lecture is we'll be looking at the link between increasing trees and exponential Reardon arrays. So as it says there, an increasing tree is a labeled rooted tree which labels along any branch from the root go in increasing order. And this is a quote from a paper by Flageolet with two colleagues. Such trees can represent permutations, data structures in computer science, and probabilistic models in diverse applications. So we'll have a look at these tomorrow. Thank you. Well, I worked in academia, but behind a desk.